And we pray, Lord, that you will continue to draw us together in a bond of love. May there be nothing as we discuss these issues that would separate us one from another, for we are one in Christ. We are family. And this church, Lord, is a church that has ministered in your name for years and years in this city, and we want that to continue. Thank you for those who are here, Lord. Thank you for the family that is not able to be here. So now we ask for your guidance. We ask, Lord, that you will help us to hear with not only ears of discernment, but with hearts of love and compassion and understanding and forbearance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Sandy. We're here this afternoon primarily for two reasons. First, you will recall a congregational survey indicated that at least 59% of our congregation wished to depart the PCUSA. And secondly, our session has not been happy with the direction that the PCUSA has been trending. In light of those facts, the session of First Pres has charged the CRC with providing timely and accurate information to the congregation concerning denominational affairs and options should this historic church decide we are to leave the PCUSA. As you already know, our next gathering will be on the 23rd, at which time Dana Allen will be joining us from the Evangelical Covenant Order. We thank you for attending the past meetings, and we thank you for being here today. We will make every effort to provide you timely and accurate information so that you may make a wise decision should this church decide to hold a vote. Any of the gatherings which you have not been able to attend are available on the church website. Our intention this afternoon is to once again remind the congregation that the session of this church intends to stay the course despite any and all distractions, and that the greater goal is to keep us together as one worshiping congregation, one in the body of Christ. At our first gathering 6 weeks ago, we addressed the property and legal issues. Today, we are here to continue our series on where we might go should we decide to leave. Over the past two gatherings, we've heard from representatives from the EPC and the PCUSA. Today, we will continue our series on denominational alignment options by presenting an overview of the fellowship community. We will focus on what the fellowship is, what it believes, what it means that First Pres is a member, and we'll ask our guest to shed some light on where he thinks the fellowship is headed in the future. We will once again have a presentation followed by questions, and out of respect for the guest's travel schedule, I will ask that we be complete at 1:30. In order to make that happen, I will ask you to keep your questions to the point and not have one person ask a long series of questions. Thank you in advance for your consideration. It is now my great pleasure to introduce to you the Reverend Dr. Paul Dederman. Paul has been a pastor at several PCUSA churches. He served as the executive director for both Presbyterians for Renewal and the Fellowship of Presbyterians. He is currently the national director of the fellowship community. Furthermore, Paul is an accomplished author. In short, Paul has spent his life in service to the Lord he loves. Welcome, Paul. We are honored by your presence this afternoon.
Thank you, sir.
Delighted to have you.
Thank you. It's kind of a welcome back. I have been in and out of First Pres many times over the last 18 years or so. The first time I was here, I was actually attending associate for worship in the theology and worship office of the PCUSA. That's what took my family and me to Louisville. And I was here in San Antonio attending, of all things, a gathering of, I guess you would call it, worship geeks, people who just do worshipy things on a regular basis for their livelihood. And you can only stand to be around people like that so long, and so I wanted to get around real people, and Sunday morning came along, And I had heard about this church. And so I came walking over. I was in one of the Riverwalk hotels. I came walking over and was greeted on the steps, ushered in to a worshiping community that embraced me so passionately that I was here for the morning service. I came back for, at that point, it was a healing service, I think about 4 o'clock in the chapel that Lou was doing. And that was my introduction to this place, and I have loved this church ever since. So it's an honor to be here. You have been a strong supporting church of Presbyterians for Renewal. You've been a supporting church of the Fellowship of Presbyterians, now the Fellowship Community. You have hosted a national or a regional gathering for us a few years ago, which I think was the last time I was probably in this chancel. And it was just a great joy to be here again with you in worship this morning. And one final thing, just as a preface to all this, is to say that as a trained church musician, I want to tell you that if you aren't treasuring every moment of the music that you enjoy in this room, you are missing the gospel. And so I just want to give special kudos to the balcony. I want to talk to you a little bit about why I am here, not necessarily here, but doing what I am doing, because that story ties in to what the fellowship community is all about. And then I want to tell you just briefly a little bit of what the fellowship community is all about. And then I want to spend the lion's share of the time answering your questions. Mark Twain famously said, "It is a terrible death to be talked to death." And I don't want to do that to anybody on a beautiful August Sunday in San Antonio, Texas, although it is much cooler in here than it is out there. So you may want to stay a little bit longer and just, I mean, there's not as much hot air flowing around in here. What I would ask is if they're on the pew, on the front pew, right over here on the baptismal font side, is a stack of literature on the fellowship community. And if we could have a couple of the servants of the Lord who would be willing to help pass that out or just send it around through. While they're doing that, I also do have to say, I made a promise, actually, to Judson and Kara Taylor that I would say hey from them while I was here. So, hey. I grew up in the church. I started off as a child sitting next to my father, who was the church choir director. I spent my Sunday afternoons playing the church organ while the music was being sorted. I hung out at the church because it was where I found the friendliest people. I was very active as a youth in the church. I was in choirs. I was in youth group. I was an acolyte. I was a youth deacon. I was confirmed in the church. I was a church organist from the age of 13. I have never, ever left the church. In fact, I've never really had a good rebellion in my life. The joke that I tell is that I even helped form a denomination that I didn't even join. So we're not talking about serious rebellion here. But it took me until age 25 years of living almost literally in the church before a congregation introduced me to the Savior. And I will tell you that if that congregation had not taken the time to examine the heart and the soul of the 25-year-old music director that they had hired for their 10 choirs and an orchestra, if they had not taken the time to look into my spiritual life, to look and ask the question of discipleship, if they had not taken the time to walk next to me and disciple me, I would not be standing here now. I would probably never have gone to seminary, and if I had, I probably would have no problem with a lot of the decisions that have been made in the PCUSA. But it was because they took the time, they invested in me to form this musician, this young guy, single guy, into a follower of Jesus, to explain the very things that Steve explained this morning and to live those out and to walk with me through that process. The reason that I am standing here is because they cared enough about me to take a church person and make him a follower of the Savior. That's what it's all about. That's why we exist, right? So it's with that that I now find myself in my calling, working with an organization who has looked at the church and who has realized that while there have been good organizational efforts on the evangelical side of the PCUSA for a long time, we have still missed the boat. The fellowship community is something that was formed in the spring of 2014. Two predecessor organizations, Presbyterians for Renewal, that had been around for a good long time. We've got early board members, we've got mid-range board members sitting in this room. Presbyterians for Renewal had run a 25-year course. It was running like any organization does to the end of its effective life cycle. The Fellowship of Presbyterians that was an effort, a project that many people, Jim Singleton and Ron Skates and other folks who have had connections with this congregation, Jim Capps, all were part of forming this Fellowship of Presbyterians. In a matter of about 3 years, because the world and the church was changing so fast, that had sort of run its at least first life cycle. These two organizations were winding down. And as I sat in my office in Louisville on a sunny Saturday morning, looking at the future that we saw, we had two choices that I could identify. One was that we say simply with both of these organizations, they have served faithfully, they have done their duty, and now it's just simply time to close it up and say it's been a good run. Or we could take the resources and the ingenuity that crafted both of those organizations and we could repurpose them into an organization that would address one question: what does the evangelical mainline church need in the 21st century? And that's what we decided to do. I took a proposal to the PFR board. They gave it consideration. They adopted it unanimously. I took the same proposal to the Fellowship of Presbyterians board. They gave it consideration. They adopted it unanimously. They both voted each other. They voted themselves, out of existence, gave themselves over to this new thing. Now, if you know biblical Greek at all, you will know that as the fellowship community, we have the most redundant name in the history of the church. Because in biblical Greek, that is koinonia, koinonia. Both fellowship and community are two aspects of this Greek word used often throughout the New Testament to talk about the body of Christ. What does it mean that we are not individuals saved by grace only, but that our salvation has a purpose? And that purpose is to build one another up in our spiritual giftedness as followers of Jesus, to direct each other to the needs of a hurting, broken world outside these windows, outside these walls, and to exist for that world, to literally do what those previous organizations did in forming the fellowship community, to help churches give themselves away constantly for the sake of the redeeming of the world around us. Making disciples, making followers of Jesus who will reproduce and make followers of Jesus, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Why did we choose to stay in the PCUSA? That's a question that we are often asked. It isn't because we couldn't imagine life anywhere else. My first thought of leaving the PCUSA, as somebody who was ordained in the PCUSA in 1990, the first inkling that I had thinking it might be a good idea to leave the PCUSA was about 1993. And I was convinced by a friend and mentor in another denomination, a related denomination that had broken off years before from the PCUSA, that God was perhaps not calling me at that time to leave yet, but rather, in a Jeremiah 29 kind of sense, bloom where you're planted, to be someone who continues in the face of opposition increasing, in the face of misdirection increasing, to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ faithfully, joyfully, powerfully, as long as I was allowed to do that. And that's the decision that I have made. And so when we started looking at this organization, ECO had formed. That's the denomination that I had had some dealings with. I helped create that. I wrote a lot of their early documents. My fingerprints are all over their archived files. But ECO had formed, the Covenant Order of Evangelical Presbyterians. It had formed for its own purpose. It was attracting the churches who, for one reason or another, decided that it was time to leave the PCUSA and go that direction. There were still, and are still, a body of churches, evangelical churches, who for whatever reason are staying and voting to stay within the PCUSA. Now, there are three categories, broad categories, that those folks fall into. The first two are fairly large. The last one is happily fairly small. The first broad category of congregations who go through the discernment process and decide to stay in the PCUSA comes from the people who say, we've thought about it, we have prayed about it, we've considered the options, and we feel very strongly that God has not given us permission to leave yet. And friends, let me tell you, whatever decision you make, and I am not here, by the way, to say you're thinking of doing what? Shame, shame, shame. I'm here to simply offer you a perspective from yet another base on the field, if you will. Think of me as the third base coach. People who enter this conversation that you are having, this discernment process, in some places, happily, this is not one of them, but in some places, that is code for we are gone, and all we have to do is convince our folks to go. We just have to sell this thing. So the leadership has huddled in, behind closed doors with the visors on in the smoke-filled room, and they have said, no, we just got to sell this church on something. That is not the way your church is operating. The discernment process, congregations go through that process, and sometimes God says, yes, you can change. I'm calling you to do to a different kind of affiliation, to a different kind of place, still within the family. But sometimes God says, no, I think you need to stay where you are, related as you are, nurturing as you are. I need you here. And so that the part of our constituency are congregations who have heard, No, please stay where you are, and I will work through you in this denomination. Another large part of our constituency are congregations who, for some reason or another, have considered the possibility of leaving the PCUSA, and it would be so divisive in the church that it actually would cripple their ministry. So it's congregations who percentages of people who want to do one thing or the other, or congregations who have very strong, broad theological spectra, but the leadership is evangelical, considering leaving the denomination would radically shatter that church. And so the leadership has said, no, we're going to stay where we are, and we're going to work this through. We're going to be God's people here. Those are the two broad areas. We have another small group of people, and those people are folks who have said, we don't want to lose this. And so if it's going to cost us the building or a lot of our assets or something, then it's not worth making the change. That's a very small group. They are part of that too. That's the gist of our constituency right now in the fellowship community. Those people all three groups of them, plus others who fall sort of between the cracks, need several things. Number one, they need to know that there are other people like them who are concerned about the things they are concerned about, who would vote on significant theological issues the way they would vote, who care about the witness, the orthodox historic witness of the church, the confessional tradition of the church, like they do. They need to know that they not only exist, but are connected. I served a church in Louisville, Kentucky. It was the evangelical congregation in its 56 church presbytery. I had elders on the session of that church who had never met another evangelically inclined Presbyterian. I had to tell them, yes, they do exist. This is what they look like. From that, I know what that feels like. There is a loneliness, there is an isolation, there is a separation that many congregations are experiencing, many pastors are experiencing. That is one of our major areas of focus. Another thing is, carryover from the PFR days, the resources that are available, especially through some of the official denominational entities, not all, but some of the official denominational entities have resources that would proclaim a different understanding of Scripture and the Lord Jesus Christ than we would proclaim, that we would be comfortable with. So, the fellowship community is designed to create resources, to create the kinds of Bible studies, the kinds of session studies, the kinds of self-examination materials, all the kinds of things that can help nurture what? Followers of Jesus who reproduce followers of Jesus. The third thing that we do is we provide a place of accountability so that you have an understanding that not only do congregations like you exist, not only are they there, not only do you see them periodically at regional, national gatherings, things like that, but that there is a way that we are connecting people intentionally. It's the kind of thing presbyteries were designed to do and haven't done for many, many decades. But it's a way of connecting people in an accountable relationship so that we have session members looking at the session members of a sister church, asking the important questions. Are you seeing evidence of the Holy Spirit at work in the lives of your people? I was out at Mo Ranch with a bunch of your folks last night. We witnessed the baptism of a young guy out in the river there. Darn near lost a lifeguard while we were at it. Have Ron Skates tell you the story because it'll be better than the way I can tell it. But, there was evidence, not of somebody simply bringing a baby forward saying we're going to do our very best, and we want to identify this child as a child of the covenant, but of a young guy who he himself said, I want to be marked as a follower of Jesus. There's the answer to that question in one instance. I'm sure in a church like this there are many others. Helping to look beyond the bureaucratic questions of, if you'll pardon me, buildings, bricks, butts, and bucks. How many people do we have in worship? Is the are the finances square, and is the building not falling in? Those are trustee questions. They're important. But the far more important question is, are lives being changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ? We're going to be meeting in a week and a half at First Presbyterian Church downtown San Diego. It's a 150-year-old congregation. They're meeting in a 100-year-old building right smack in the heart of downtown San Diego. Parking is atrocious. Greeting the national gathering of the fellowship community on the 18th, 19th, and 20th of August will be a core of people from the rescue mission that First Presbyterian Church is in ministry partnership with. They will be wearing, I'm told, incredibly bright green T-shirts and caps to identify themselves. They want to be identified, they want to be seen, because these are people who, a year ago, were neither clean nor sober, nor seeing any evidence of God in their life, and now they are clean, sober, and experiencing the transforming grace of the Lord Jesus Christ in their lives. That is the gospel at work. That's the kind of thing that we are wanting to draw out and help people realize, because folks, for so many people, and you will find this hard to believe, but for so many people who are part of congregations, who are part of the fellowship, it has been so long since they have seen tangible, palpable evidence of gospel transformation. And this is one of the reasons why the denomination, aggregate of people who come together to vote in a very democratic process, is struggling. It's why it's in the weeds. It's why it's making choices that don't seem to resonate with the gospel. It's because, as an aggregate, a majority of our people either do not know the scriptures well or do not understand the essence of the gospel well. Nobody is coming together at a general assembly saying, let's see if we can destroy the church. But there is a power behind them, puppeteering through our culture and our church, that is out to destroy the body of Christ, and it is against him and him alone that we stand. That's the fellowship community in a nutshell. I haven't touched on a lot of it. I want to get to your questions, but I will tell you that the reason this makes sense to me is because for the first quarter century of my life, I was one of those people. I knew the hymns. I knew the anthems. I could play a wicked postlude. I could form a great choir. And then I met Jesus, and I understood why all of that truly was important. That's what we are trying to do with the fellowship community, is to help people who are in the mainline church, PCUSA and anyone else that wants to work with us, understand why it is so important that we proclaim Jesus and him alone. I'd love to take questions. I will do my best to answer them. I will tell you that my answer may be I don't know, but that will be the honest answer. I don't make things up. I play poker face cards face up. It's really annoying, but I want to be that transparent. So love to take questions that you have.
Hi, I'm Jean Swanson, and I have a statement I'd like to make to this congregation. I've been a Presbyterian all my life, and I've been a member of this church for 25 years. I joined this church because of its diversity, and I would like to ask its members to remember that we have varying opinions and may not agree on everything. We need to be respectful and civil to each other when voicing our views. When we hear the speakers and the church members who make the statements and ask questions, it is important to listen with an open mind so that we will be able to make an informed decision when we are asked to vote on whether we stay with PCUSA or leave. Thank you.
Amen.
I think we can say amen to that.
Thank you for coming and speaking with us today. I have a question for you. In light of these actions, Presbytery's obstructionist role in the calling of our interim pastor, Ron Skates, Joe Reitmeier being defrocked after he'd already retired by Grace Presbytery, and our own interim senior pastor now facing charges in our own presbytery, how can we anticipate that we will be able to do the work that we want to do without interference from our own presbytery?
That's a very honest, good question. We can't anticipate what is going to come. I'm going to be on two United Airlines flights. I can give you the flight numbers if you are a specific prayer. I have no anticipation of landing in Louisville, Kentucky. One of those planes could go down. It's happened before. There have been planes that have gone down. Do I expect to be home and greet my wife at the Louisville airport at about 10:30 tonight? Yes. But I have no assurance of that. The gospel does not call us to live an assured life. I understand that this is, I understand that your question is here, and I'm doing this, but I'm going to come back to you right in just a second here. One of the things that we take for granted, because we grew up in the church that we did, we grew up in the cultural climate that we did, we grew up in the culture that we did, we take for granted that the church, at least internally, should be solidly supportive of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is not our current reality. It's not a current reality in the PCUSA, or in the United Methodist Church, or in the Episcopal Church, the Lutheran Church, pick your place. It is also not a reality, by the way, in congregations and denominations that profess a right-sounding gospel, that motivates human beings, fallen human beings, to live in mission of that, in the living out of that gospel, in missional living. What happens is that no matter where we are, whether it's the PCUSA, ECO, EPC, PCA, any of the split pea soup, we need to be building the strength of the congregation that can withstand the challenges from outside, whether it's the presbytery or the actions of the General Assembly or the challenges of the culture outside these walls. This church, if I understand my history right, sat right in its early days between two saloons on a different location in town, both of whom on Sunday morning were trying very hard to distract the congregation from the worship of God. If that isn't a true story, it's a great story that Ron Skates tells. That's an outward and visible sign of the very thing you're talking about. We're not used to facing those challenges within our own denomination. That's just counterintuitive to us. But that's the situation that we face, and that's the situation in various ways that a church is going to face regardless of what name is on the signboard outside. The challenge is to build and nurture the strength of the congregation to withstand that. As you know, in the call of a pastor, the call of a pastor is a three-way call. It's the presbytery, it's the congregation, and it's the candidate. It's the person you're talking to. Two out of three of those people can agree on that, and if there is a problem from the presbytery, it has to be a legitimate problem. This person has to have committed some atrocity that is against the very teaching of the Book of Order. There has to be sexual malfeasance. There has to be financial malfeasance. There has to be a personality disorder, something along that line. If you are experiencing a challenge, and I don't know the details, so I'm answering in generalization here, but if you have experienced challenges with the calling of an interim pastor, you may be anticipating that there would be challenges to calling the specific kind of senior pastor that you want. But the Book of Order is very clear that a call cannot be denied to somebody who professes biblical orthodox confessional theology. If this needs to be if that would be the ruling of the Committee on Ministry of any given presbytery, that can be appealed. The Book of Order, the Constitution of the Church, stands behind you in affirming that you can call the person that you feel God has called here. That doesn't mean it's a free skate. You mentioned Joe Reitmeier in Grace Presbytery. That is a very different, very specific situation. I will say this is Paul Detterman speaking, I'm not speaking for the fellowship community. I would not do that without my board. But I will say that the actions from what I saw of Grace Presbytery against Joe Reitmeier when Highland Park Press left the presbytery were punitive. And they were tragic. They in no way represented the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was an unfortunate decision. God's people have made unfortunate decisions for at least 4,000 years that we know about. We are in a situation where unfortunate decisions are being made around us, but you will find that in any denomination.
One follow-up comment on that, and that is this. When I'm getting ready to get on a flight, if I noticed that the airline had gone down three times, I would not walk the jetway.
David West, I've been a member here since 1984, currently ruling elder. I wouldn't ask you this question, except I've heard you speak on this, Paul. We have members of this church who are gay or lesbian. We have families in this church who have either siblings or children in that same category. A lot of people feel that with the teachings of this particular church and the fellowship, that those who are gay or lesbian or the families would not be welcome either in this church or in the fellowship. What would you say to those people who don't feel welcome? And what would you say to someone who says, I don't think there's a place for me anymore in the Christian faith?
That's an extraordinarily good question. The first thing that I would say is shame on us. Because the welcome of the gospel of Jesus Christ is to any and all of God's children, irrespective of their gender, irrespective of their sexual orientation. None of us, as we heard in the lesson this morning, has any right to the claims of the gospel of Jesus, except that Jesus Christ died for us all. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's the proof of God's amazing love. The issue that we have is an issue that has two, in terms of relating to people with same-sex attraction or relating to their families, the issue that we have with that is two-faceted. On one hand, we have a culture that is stereotyping the church. That's one problem. On the other hand, we have a church, in many instances, that is living into that stereotype. What we have to understand is that the questions that people are asking about their sexual orientation are no different than the questions that people are asking about any number of other things. We have to understand that the gospel of Jesus Christ, when it is proclaimed in its fullness, is going to be offensive to absolutely every person in this room at some point. Or to put it more plainly, if you are not in some way offended by something in the gospel of Jesus Christ, you are not hearing the full gospel. Because all of us live in opposition to the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're a fallen humanity. And it's the work of the Holy Spirit within us that turns minds and hearts, that helps us to see God's intention for us, that helps us to understand how we can live together in our differences, how we can be gentle with one another, and how we can look for the redeeming of the world. And that includes sexual orientation. In one of your rooms upstairs, when we had our regional gathering here, one of the things that I shared was a metaphor that I've used quite a bit since. You heard it first here. But that is that the evangelical church, the churches who claim to have good news to share, to see good news of salvation in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the churches who are made up of people who understand that this is where I was before I met Jesus and this is where I am headed now, the people who see that transformation have, in effect, the job of a first baseman on a baseball team. The job of a first baseman on a baseball team is twofold. Number one, he or she has to keep their foot on first base. If you take your foot off the base and try and make the play, you can have the most spectacular catch in the world, but if you are not tagged up on the base, it doesn't mean a thing. Our job is to keep our foot firmly planted on the gospel of Jesus Christ, because if we lose that in any one of our, in any possible direction, if we lose our touch with the gospel, it's over. We've got nothing. The second job, however, of a first baseman is equally important, and that is, with their foot firmly planted on that base, they have to reach as far as they possibly can to make that play. And our job, in a culture that is very suspicious at best of the things that happen in this room and places just like at other churches, they are very suspicious of the church. They have heard the church say bigoted things. They have heard the church say unloving things. They have heard the church say unwelcoming things. They have been shunned or hurt or sometimes abused by the church. Our job is to reach as far as we possibly can while we are tethered to the gospel in an embrace that says, we have a lot to apologize for and we want to welcome you. I will never apologize for what the gospel says about marriage. I will never apologize for what the gospel says about human sexuality, about God's design for this incredible, beautiful gift he has given us of sexuality. We have a lot to apologize for about the way sexuality is expressed, even in heterosexual relationships in most churches. We have a lot to apologize for about the way that we have been, we have just turned people off when they have asked questions that seem to be outside of the norm. But folks, there is no us and them in the body of Christ. There is no us and them in the world. There is a fallen humanity, and there is the Redeemer of that fallen humanity. That is the only separation we have. And so our job is to be welcoming, to be embracing, to listen to questions, to honor people, to love people where they are, and to answer those questions with the gospel as strongly and as clearly and as compassionately as we possibly can. And there's 1,000 questions being asked. I was in a situation in one of my congregations where a gay couple came. It was a small town. They were very well known in town. They had not felt an embrace from any congregation. They asked if they could come and if they could be part of First Presbyterian Church in that town. I welcomed them with open arms, and I said, you do understand that when the gospel speaks about sexuality, you may hear some things that are going to be difficult for you to hear. And their response was, well, duh. You wouldn't be preaching the gospel if it was easy to hear for anybody, would you? And with that, we welcomed them into the fabric of the church. I use that not as the solo illustration, but as one possible illustration of what I'm trying to say. Our embrace has to be as wide as the embrace of Christ. Our welcome has to be genuine. And we have to be able to answer, however, truthful questions with biblical truth. Because we don't love anybody, we don't affirm anybody, we don't value anybody by lying to them about what the gospel says, about what Scripture says. We do, however, need to listen to one another. And to listen to the Holy Spirit, who just might be speaking through surprising people in surprising ways in any topic.
My name is Katie Bedena. I'm a member of this church, and I'm a very mission-oriented person. I've just received a mission newsletter, which says, basically, because of financial constraints, Presbyterian World Mission has had to recall missions personnel for the first time in decades. This is a process which began 178 years ago. It has been something that has been a very important part of PCUSA during all of that time. To speak specifically, there are three Central American, South American missions who have been serving in theological education. They're skilled veterans whose work was deeply valued by our mission partners. All will have to be will have to leave by the end of the year to make their plans for the future. How can we abandon an effort that has been a basic part of our denomination for such a long time? Right now, according to this information that I've received, is that less than a half cent of the donations to PCUSA go to basic mission support. I don't understand that.
I affirm your deep concern for that. And again, understand that I am not standing here to say, I want to affirm everything the PCUSA is doing. I can't say that. If I could say that, there wouldn't be a need for the organization that I head up. One of the beautiful things about our Presbyterian family, broadly speaking, including ECO, the Covenant Order of Evangelical Presbyterians, and the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, and the PCUSA, one of the beautiful things that we have are the joint mission partners, the Outreach Foundation, the Presbyterian Frontier Fellowship, and the Antioch Partners, the Medical Benevolence Association, various groups like that, who are functioning now across the denominational platforms. You know this. You have hosted the missions conferences, at least two of them that I know of here. That's the reason they exist, is because we, in our North American complacency, have devalued the phenomenal work of that we have in our history beyond the North American continent, South America, the indigenous peoples in this country and in Canada, Asia, the Middle East. One of the things that is equally important to what happens on the streets of San Antonio from this church is the reach of San Antonio. We heard the reach of this church beyond San Antonio. We heard the witness this morning of the folks who sort of stuck their little toe into an immersion experience in Costa Rica and came back with a glowing report of what they saw God doing there. Again, if we lose track of the mission of the gospel in the streets outside this building, to the people who walk past this place every day, and to people halfway around the world, we have lost the power of the gospel. We've lost the purpose for which you and I have been called as followers of Jesus Christ. Our purpose is to share the gospel. And you know, the challenge is that, as anybody will tell you, you want to find out what your priorities are individually, as a family, in the club that you belong to, in the church that you belong to, or as a denomination. If you want to find out what the priorities are, look at your checkbook. That will tell you in very clear terms where you are spending your money. One of the things that we are working to do as a fellowship community in the PCUSA, as a continuing evangelical witness, is to keep the global connections alive. We have people coming to San Diego to the national gathering that we have on 18th to the 20th of August. Our opening speaker, our opening preacher, the first night of the gathering, is Boutros Zaour, long tenured pastor of the Presbyterian Church in Damascus. We think we've got persecution because a presbytery is questioning the call of an interim pastor. They can sing hymns with the organ intermittently when the shelling stops and the electricity comes back on. Another person that we have joining us there is Davidson Chifungo from Malawi. We have people who have spent remarkable amounts of time in various mission endeavors across the globe, and we are holding them close to us in the same kind of accountability that you're asking for. Because if we are not supporting world mission, if we are not supporting the spread of the gospel, again, why do we exist? Why do we exist? We're a Rotary Club with a choir. And so that's exactly right. I would tell you, you've identified an issue. I will also say, in any denomination that you look at, please, please look at with the same criteria. Look where the money is being spent. Look at the missions that are being supported. Make that part of your discernment process.
I understand it. There are three sources to fund the sending and support of our mission workers. Basic mission support, which is from congregations, investment income, and designated support from local congregations. And I would emphasize the word designated. Investment income for supporting Presbyterian World Missions is almost exhausted, which is why we need local congregations and individual churches to supplement that half cent that comes from PCUSA. If we have money to conduct a big thing like the Big Tent, which is, from the information I got, a lot of people got a lot of expenses paid in order to attend that local organization. In this country, why can't we continue the mission work that we've been doing for 178 years? It makes no sense.
That question, articulated with that kind of passion, is part of the reason that the fellowship community is existing in the PCUSA, so people continue to ask that kind of question. You mentioned about one of the things in terms of designated giving. The Presbyterian Foundation, Tom Taylor is the CEO. Tom is a great friend of the evangelical movement within the PCUSA. He pastored several large evangelical churches. Tom is CEO of the foundation at this point. He is making a presentation at our national gathering because congregations affiliated currently with the fellowship community have supported Wycliffe Bible translators, and I had to see this in writing to make sure that I had not misheard it, had supported the fellowship community congregations over the years, have supported the Wycliffe Bible translators to the tune of $12 million. So the Word of God could be in the hands of people in distant parts of the world in their own language. That's the kind of designated giving that will help make the mission cause work.
Absolutely. I just want to follow up a question to clarify for you all. As the past chair of the Global Missions, this church is not dependent on the PCUSA to guide and fund its missionary efforts for some time. The Antioch Partners, Outreach Foundation, Presbyterian churches of all the four major Presbyterian denominations work through those organizations, give money directly to those organizations. The Iraq relief that I've discussed with you goes directly through the Outreach Foundation.
Right.
So the fact that the PCUSA is dwindling in this area doesn't mean that First Pres is misguided or dwindling.
Right.
George Spencer, member since 1979 and currently a ruling elder. You have candidly acknowledged the flaws and challenges we have as a congregation in the PCUSA. But earlier this afternoon, you said that were this congregation to go to a different group, a different denomination, we would find we wouldn't escape from problems. We would simply find different ones and different limitations. Speaking purely as an individual and not on behalf of your organization, could you share with us any observations you have about the challenges, the limitations, the problems that those other organizations such as ECO and Evangelical Presbyterian Church may have? Thank you.
I'll be glad to make some general statements. I don't want to go down specifically in this forum and say, well, if you look to join ECO, I would be watch out for this, this, and this. Or if you look at the EPC, watch out for this, this, and this. Because I'm not in a position to do that. I'm just not in a position to do that in a forum like this. I will say broadly, Denominations, first of all, we need to realize what denominations are and what they aren't. Again, we've inherited a structure, we've inherited a church. A lot of you have been very kind to share your tenure at this particular church. We've inherited a mindset in our time that places an inordinate amount of emphasis on this thing called a denomination, which is, in all honesty, a 20th century innovation that, bureaucratically speaking, has moved through its life cycle very much the way that I described PFR and the Fellowship of Presbyterians and, of course, the Fellowship community, anything else. In the 21st century, we are in what most people acknowledge to be the declining days of the importance of denominational affiliation. Now, again, that's hard for us who lived most of our lives in the last half of the 20th century to wrap our heads around. Of course they're important. Corporations are important. Anybody who is over 30 or 40, well, 35 years old at this point, name the big three. Right? There's all sorts of things that we could talk about in terms of corporate America. Denominations are a vestige in the church of corporate America. So that, to put not too fine a point on it, a denominational affiliation has its importance, but let me just stress, and I can't stress this too strongly, that the importance of this conversation that we are having right now stops about 18 inches shy of the outside walls of this room. Nobody outside this building, nobody in your neighborhood, nobody that you are helping in the San Antonio area, nobody cares what kind of Presbyterian, how do you spell that again? What kind of Presbyterian church you are. They care about how much you care for them. They care about how much of the goods, assets, and services that you have that keeps a complex like this going, you're willing to give to mission to them. They care about how much you are willing to invest in the improvement of their lives and of the city. And you can multiply that further out. So that with that understanding, what does a denomination do then? How is this sort of odd beast still important to us? Well, it's important in several ways. It's important to us because, in the words of Mrs. Oliver Wendell Holmes, everyone must belong to something. The second half of that quote would not be terribly helpful right at the moment, but there's the first half. Even independent churches, you've got some of them here in San Antonio. We've got a behemoth in Louisville. We've got a little place up there that runs about 22,000 people a weekend. Even independent churches have created their own denomination, if you will, because it's an affiliation. It's kind of who we are, and it's kind of, you know, we sort of remember who we are. And that's important in a way, but there's the first challenge. Because make very sure that the theological foundation of any denomination you look at is really who you are. Make very sure that it defines with you, not for you, with you, your theological identity. Make sure that it articulates with you something that you can grab onto and say, yeah, we're there. That's a problem in the PCUSA right at the moment, because the PCUSA is articulating things that a lot of us don't agree with. That's why we are an on-the-ground mission in the PCUSA, to keep the loyal opposition voice going. And that's a whole other answer. That's a whole other question. That's a whole other answer. So the first thing is the theological foundation. The second thing is watch where the money goes. Look very, very closely. Scrutinize over the shoulder of whoever you have talking to you where their money goes. how much of their money is being directed toward the maintaining of the denomination and the expansion of the denomination in an era when denominations really aren't that important, and how much of their money, how much of the money that you would be contributing goes directly to the proclamation of the gospel, directly to the transformation of human lives, directly to the mission of the gospel in the world. And the third thing that I would say, beyond the theological identity and the fiscal landscape of the denomination, is make very sure that they care as much about you as you care about making a move to them. Let me say that again. Make sure that they care as much about you, investing in you, nurturing you, supporting you, defending you, as you are investing in making the move to them. That's the way I would answer that in this type of forum. I can give you my email address for some specifics offline.
My question is, I have read Why Stay in the PCUSA numerous times since you've been talking, and I am confused as to why you openly say that we don't agree with decisions by PCUSA. So the only thing I can come up with from their perspective might be you keep your friends close, you keep your enemies closer. What advantage do they have? You're openly saying you don't agree with them. Why is PCA allowing you to have fellowship, allowing, it just doesn't make sense to me. It very much, we're continuing in something we don't agree with, some of us, not everyone. I do not understand PCA USA's reasoning for allowing fellowship to openly disagree with them.
Sure. There's a couple answers to that. The first answer that I would give is, remember that the people who are now in the determining places in the PCUSA have existed most of their lives in a denomination that they didn't agree with. See what I'm saying? The people who are the people who have won the votes now. This isn't something that, you know, it's always been a liberal denomination, and we've always been in agreement. A year before I stood in this church for the very first time was the year at the, I believe it was Albuquerque General Assembly, that the specific language that prohibited self-avowed practicing homosexual pastors from being ordained, or elders and deacons from being ordained, was passed by the General Assembly. The people who are in the positions of influence now in the theological trajectory that we disagree with have been in our place most, if not all, of their lives up to this moment. So they get it. And they would be the last ones to say, well, you know, nobody can question the PCUSA. If we've made the decision, if you don't go, you know, lockstep or you're out, buddy. They would be the last people to say that, because If that had been the order of the day, they would have been out long ago. So there is that. The other thing is that within this is not a monolithic conversation. In other words, on the subject of same-gender marriage, a small margin that constituted a very small majority of a General Assembly passed something in assembly that later went through the presbyteries and was passed by reasonably small margins. There are two reasons why the redefinition of marriage passed. Number one, the tenacity of the people who wanted to see it passed. And number two, the defection from voting of the people who didn't want to see it passed. So in both situations, quite honestly, in many places throughout the PCUSA, if we who claim an orthodox understanding of theology and scripture had had the tenacity for Jesus that the revisionists have had for their agenda, we wouldn't have allowed it to happen yet. The culture is moving that way. The Supreme Court has made its the legal decision now in the United States. Agree with it or not, it's a decision that's been made. We would be in a very different place if we had held the course, right? So that said, the people on the other side of the aisle are not monolithic. I know many theological, cultural progressives who do not approve of same-sex marriage, who are functioning, teaching, and ruling elders in the Presbyterian Church USA. On the marriage issue, they would be standing next to me saying, no, this is not right. We've made a major goof here. They are not going to be ones who are eager to see the fellowship community and its constituency leave. Because in the words of one of those people, who is a member of the Covenant Network of Presbyterians, who is a pastor of a fairly liberal congregation, I don't want to be the conservative in the denomination. They want to have an engagement with those who believe what we believe, those who profess what we profess. And I will tell you, after being now just shy of 10 years in a position of national leadership on the evangelical side, I have more access to meaningful conversations, access to questions that are being asked. I have been interrogated by theological progressives more completely in the last 18 months than I was in the last 8 years before that. They are seeking to hear what we have to say. Now, that is incredibly important to hear. Because, and this is one of my other soapboxes, so just disclaimer, brief soapbox here, we better get our act together and be able to articulate the gospel. Because people who have theological differences from us in the church and people who have cultural differences from us in the culture, in the secular culture around us, are watching us right now to see how we respond. This goes back to the question about the welcome and the embrace of people who have same-sex attraction and family members families with people who are gay and lesbian, transgendered, questioning. The way that we handle, the spirit in which we handle the redeeming truth of the gospel, the way that we proclaim that, not only with our lips, but much more with our embrace, with our lives, our willingness to sit down with somebody who differs from us remarkably and have a biblically based, calm, confident conversation has never been a greater challenge than it is right now. And my deepest fear, sisters and brothers, is that we will not live up to that challenge. We're not prepared for that. We've had the dominant voice. We've had the ability to say, well, the Bible says it and I believe it, so that's it. We've had the ability to say, well, the church has not questioned this for 2,000 years. We're not about to question it now. Those questions, those answers don't wash anymore. We have everything we need to make a compelling witness. And I'm saying this to you regardless of what name is on this church by January 1st or whenever. But sisters and brothers, in the gospel of Jesus Christ, in God's word, we have everything we need to make a compassionate, compelling witness to the transforming love and grace of Jesus Christ. Where we will fail, if we fail, is in our own patience with the questions, in our insecurity of the gospel, in our insecurity of how we know of Scripture, and in our own elitism that says, I don't want to talk to those people. And if any of those things haunt us, if any of those things form our witness, then shame on us, because God has given us his redeeming word. God has given us his redeeming son. God has paid the price for our transgressions, for our sin, so that we can, with absolute gospel confidence, share that transforming grace with anybody we meet in this world. You know the reality of the gospel? The reality of the gospel, the essence of the gospel, is that we are more sinful than we can ever imagine. And in Jesus Christ, we are more loved than we can ever know. And the reality of the gospel is simultaneously, if we get this, if we understand this, We know that we are such a sinner that Christ Jesus had to die for us. We will never, ever look down on anybody else. But we also know that, as we heard from this pulpit this morning, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God looks at us and sees an inestimable treasure. And if that doesn't compel us to give everything we have into the people around us in this world, if that does not compel us to give ourselves away in radical Christ-following discipleship and in radical compassionate love into a world that is screaming to know the Savior, whether they know it or not, I don't know what will. There is no conversation that we have to shrink from. There is no question that is too difficult. We have been given everything we need to be His witnesses. That's my prayer for each one of us.
Dirk, we have time for one more. Paul, my name is Chuck Bunn. I'm the chief sinner here. You blessed me abundantly several years ago when you came here, and it was an epiphany of how culture looks at us and sees us as the enemy. And your quite eloquent words that day, you repeated today with your metaphor about the first baseman. So I'll keep my question short with that in mind. As a member church of the PCUSA, we at least give tacit approval for the changes that go on there. With that said, are we not taking our foot off first base when we no longer recognize sin as sin? Or are we in danger of losing our first love when we whitewash the gospel so that fewer are offended?
If we were to refuse to acknowledge that sin is sin, if we were to whitewash the gospel, then yes, absolutely. This is a dangerous question to ask, so it is totally rhetorical, because I've got a bad knee right at the moment. I cannot make it to the back door fast enough for this place to erupt. So just let me just ask the question, although there is a side door. Cover me. How many of you approve of every decision our president makes? How many of you approve of every decision our Congress makes? How many of you approve of every decision the Supreme Court makes? Are you leaving the United States? You are not giving tacit approval. You are saying, we have mortal leaders. They are doing, in their minds and hearts, they are doing the best they can, but they are making wrong decisions. Translate that. There is nothing holy about the PCUSA. Now, please don't take that out of context. If anybody live tweets that as the one thing I said today, I'm done. There is nothing holy about the PCUSA. There is nothing totally redeemed about the people who gather at any General Assembly or the people who serve in Louisville. They are all, like every one of us, flawed human beings. Can they make boneheaded decisions? Can they make wrong decisions? Can they, with every good intention, misunderstand the leading of the Holy Spirit? Absolutely. Every single one of us in this room can. That does not mean, just because the General Assembly has said something, does not mean that this or any other church gives tacit approval. We stand in loyal opposition. We stand in loyal opposition. The problem is when we stop opposing the things that we know are not of God. I was asked a question last night. You all apparently are the nice people, because the people last night asked a very pointed question. Don't tell them I said that. The very, very pointed question was, why don't you just leave? You've nibbled at that, but nobody's really come out with it yet. The reason that I don't leave is because I know there are people like me in at least 200 congregations remaining in the PCUSA and lots, lots more. And I don't want to give up on people who are seeking to understand gospel truth and looking to the denomination to say, is this right? So long we have looked at the denomination, we've looked at a presbytery, we've looked at even a pastor, a given pastor, and said, is this right? All of those may be appropriate at times, but are ill-advised at other times. We need to look at the scripture. I'm not making this up. This is the Book of Order. We need to look at your Book of Order, PCUSA Book of Order. We need to look at the scripture through the lens of the confession, guided and directed by the Holy Spirit to say, is this thing we are considering right? Friends, we have every right to be in loyal opposition to the decisions made by the PCUSA. The problem is, are we willing to voice that opposition? We have every right to call whomever God leads to that or any other pulpit. You have every right. The pastors of this church, the session of this church, has every right and always had to determine who will be married on these steps. Those rights are still intact. The question is, are we seeing this as a mission field? Are we seeing this as part of our mission? I look at the PCUSA. I look at the challenges of the questions that are being asked there, of the conversations that are. I look at that like I would at an emerging world country that has not really yet heard the gospel. They think they have. And I don't say that in any arrogance. Please don't hear that arrogantly. I say that in the humility of somebody who thought, for the first quarter of my life, that I kind of had a grip on the gospel. And the only thing I learned when I came to know the Savior was how much I didn't know, except that Jesus loves me and looks at me in all my flaws, in all my failings, in all the stupid decisions that I've made, and if you had another hour, I could itemize the top 50 of those. Jesus looks at me and says, my beloved. He looks at you and says, my beloved. He looks at the gay couple on the steps of the church and says, my beloved. He looks at a world trying desperately to find everything he is offering in all the wrong places, and he stays with us. That's the Lord we need to profess, regardless of how we arrange the letters on the signboard. Thank you. One more follow-up.
I just wanted one kind of clarification. I've gotten to listen to you a number of times, and it's always a blessing, and we really appreciate you being here. I admire you for your leadership in this area. When you described the churches that are in the fellowship now, and we're one, and I've believed it was a great place to be, in my mind, temporarily, it sounds like Babylon. It sounds like being in exile. And I've been to a couple of eco-fellowship gatherings, and they're amazing spirit-filled events. One of the ministers there, and you'd remember, could have been you, gave a very an awesome talk on living in exile, which sounds like what you're describing of those couple of those groups of congregations that you're representing. And at the time, my closing thought was, I don't want to be that. I don't want to live in exile forever here at First Pres. And that's been something that's been on my heart ever since. And so you've kind of closed, but can you get that tension between trying to be a light, which you're doing a marvelous job, and living in exile, ongoing, and a church trying to decide that?
Sure can. Well, I don't know if I can do a great job. I'll try. Short. I got that. In musical terms, this is called an encore, right? The person you're thinking of is Mark Labberton, and no one would be more horrified at the thought of him and me being confused as he. So it was Labberton who did the wonderful thing, and it's from his book, The Dangerous Act of Worship. By the way, if you have an hour and a half that you would like to commit to something that will change your life, I would really recommend that you buy Mark Labberton's new book. It simply is, the title is Called, C-A-L-L-E-D, Mark Labberton, President of Fuller Seminary. The question on exile, two things that I would say to that. Number one, exile, and I would say that if Mark was sitting right here, we've got to be very careful about how we use that metaphor. We are living in a time of marginalization that is not exile. This is not Babylon. We are not in captivity. We may have people saying to us, you know, sing us one of the songs of Zion, but there are no swords pointed at us when they say it. So please don't let anybody overstate the situation we find ourselves in. We are in a place of marginalization. The church is now in the culture where most of the culture has been in the world of the church for about 1,500 years. The tables have turned, and we better get used to it. Because Babylon, if you will, or the exile, just to keep the metaphor going for clarity, with my little disclaimer in place, is not the PCUSA, folks. Let me say that again just to make sure you hear it. The exile is not in the PCUSA. We are in a position where we are on the losing side of some votes. That's not a position that we have been necessarily terribly familiar with on the important things. We've lost some important ones. I think the marriage vote is cosmically important. But don't overstate that. We are simply on the losing side of that, all right? Nobody is carting us off into slavery. Nobody is silencing us. I can stand in this speaking into something that I know will be on the World Wide Web before I get to Louisville, Kentucky, and I can speak to you openly about this, and I have no fear of retribution from the PCUSA because I am an ordained teaching elder, and I am allowed this freedom, right? Any place you go, whether it's PCUSA, whether it's EPC, whether it's PCA, whether it's ECO, whether it's whatever, name it. Every church that professes the life-transforming gospel of Jesus Christ in a countercultural way is going to be in this culture in a marginalized place, in cultural exile, if you will. And the culture and the forces of secularization, which is its own religion, that's a whole other afternoon's conversation. Secularism is its own religion. That religion is now has the dominant place in our culture. And I resonate so much with what you say. I don't want to be there either, but guess what? We are and we will be for the rest of our lives. And no denominational change is going to change that. The question is, what denominational affiliation will best allow you to proclaim the gospel you know, the Lord you know, with the passion you get from him into a culture? And it's going to changing the name on the church, changing the affiliation does not change the challenge. Does not change the challenge. It simply is a matter of saying, how do we move beyond this to the place where we are doing sincere ministry? Last audacious thing, I know, I feel it, all right? You're a nice guy, but man, you've got a stare. The denominational question, preoccupation with the denominational question is the work of the enemy in our midst. I don't care which side you are on. Make a decision, get over it, and get on with ministry. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Paul.